Greetings and peace to you. I hope you're well and in good health, of a sober mind and in spiritual equilibrium on this Thursday in the third week of Lent. Today, as has been the custom, we will be going through the spiritual lessons of the old breviary and the new. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Ghost, Creator blessed, and in our hearts take up thy rest. Come with thy grace and heavenly aid to fill the hearts which thou hast made. To fill the hearts which thou hast made. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. At that time, Jesus rose from the synagogue and entered Simon's house. Now, Simon's mother-in-law was suffering from a great fever, etc. The word of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ. A homily of St. Ambrose, Bishop. Observe the merciful forbearance of the Lord our Savior, unruffled when presented with just cause for indignation, unoffended by sin, uninjured by affronts. He does not abandon the Jewish people. Rather, heedless of offense, he shows himself mindful of mercy and seeks to soften the hearts of that unbelieving people, now by teaching, now by freeing the possessed, now by healing. Well does Luke describe the deliverance of the man from an evil spirit, and follow with the healing of a woman. For the Lord had come to cure both sexes, but he who had been first created should be the first healed. And she whose sin arose from fickleness rather than perversity should not be passed over. Responsory. Seeing Joseph in the distance, the brothers said to one another, "Here comes that dreamer. Let us kill him, and see then whether his dreams do him any good." Versicle. When his brothers saw that their father loved Joseph best of all his sons, they hated him and could not even greet him. Hence they said, "Let us kill him and see then whether his dreams do him in continuation of the lesson. The Sabbath marks the beginning of our Lord's healing work. He begins the new creation where the old left off. And there, at the very beginning, it is shown that God's Son is not subject to the law, but above it, and that the law is not destroyed, but fulfilled. For the world was not made through the law, but by the word, as we read, by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. And so, the law is not destroyed, but fulfilled. That the renewal of now prostrate mankind may be accomplished. Hence the apostle says, strip off the old man and put on the new, who is made according to God's image. Responsory. Judas said to his brothers, look, some Ishmaelites are passing by. Come, let us sell him, and not defile our hands. For he is our brother, our own flesh. Versicle. What is to be gained by killing our brother, and concealing his blood? Let us sell him, and not defile our hands. For he is our brother, our own flesh. Continuation of the lesson. And fittingly did Jesus begin on the Sabbath in order to show himself as creator, taking up the thread and continuing the work he had begun. If a carpenter gets ready to renovate a house, he starts taking the old parts off at the roof, not at the foundations. And so the Lord first puts up his hand to the task on the same day on which he had previously left off, and he begins with lesser things and progresses to the greater. Men too are able to set people free from the devil, though only by God's word. But God's power alone can command the dead to rise. Perhaps we can see in that woman, the mother-in-law of Simon and Andrew, a figure of our own flesh, languishing with sin's various fevers, and burning with the immoderate urges of the various passions. I would say that this fever of desire is no less burning than the heat of physical fever. The one sets our soul on fire, the other our body. For our fever is greed, our fever is lust, our fever is intemperance, Our fever is ambition. Our fever is anger. Responsory. Drawing Joseph up out of the cistern, they sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. When Reuben went back to the cistern and saw that Joseph was not in it, he rent his garments, weeping, and said, "The boy is not there, and I, where shall I turn?" Versicle. But they, after dipping Joseph's tunic in the blood of a goat, sent someone who brought the tunic to their father with the message, "See whether it is your son's tunic or not." When Reuben went back to the cistern and saw that Joseph was not in it, he rent his garments weeping and said, "The boy is not there. I, where shall I turn?" Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. The boy is not there, and I, where shall I turn? Thus ends the readings from the old office. On to the new. From the Treatise on Prayer by Tertullian, priest. The spiritual offering of prayer. Prayer is the offering in spirit that has done away with the sacrifices of old. What good do I receive from the multiplicity of your sacrifices? Asks God. I have had enough of burnt offerings of rams, and I do not want the fat of lambs and the blood of bulls and goats. Who has asked for these from your hands? What God has asked for, we learn from the gospel. The hour will come, he says, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit, and so he looks for worshipers who are like himself. We are true worshipers and true priests. We pray in spirit, and so offer in spirit the sacrifice of prayer. Prayer is an offering that belongs to God and is acceptable to him. It is the offering he has asked for, the offering he planned as his own. We must dedicate this offering with our whole heart. We must fatten it on faith, tend it by truth, keep it unblemished through innocence and clean through chastity, and crown it with love. We must escort it to the altar of God in a procession of good works, to the sound of psalms and hymns. Then it will gain for us all that we ask of God. Since God asks for prayer offered in spirit and in truth, how can he deny anything to this kind of prayer? How great is the evidence of its power as we read and hear and believe? Of old, Prayer was able to rescue from fire and beasts and hunger even before it received its perfection from Christ. How much greater then is the power of Christian prayer? No longer does prayer bring an angel of comfort to the heart of a fiery furnace, or close up the mouths of lions, or transport to the hungry food from the fields. No longer does it remove all sense of pain by the grace it wins for others, but it gives the armor of patience to those who suffer, who feel pain, who are distressed. It strengthens the power of grace so that faith may know what it is gaining from the Lord and understand what it is suffering for the name of God. In the past, prayer was able to bring down punishment, rout armies, withhold the blessing of rain. Now, however, the prayer of the just turns aside the whole anger of God, keeps vigil for its enemies, pleads for persecutors. Is it any wonder that it can call down water from heaven when it could obtain fire from heaven as well? Prayer is the one thing that can conquer God. But Christ has willed that it should work no evil and has given it all power over good. Its only art is to call back the souls of the dead from the very journey into death, to give strength to the weak, to heal the sick, to exorcise the possessed, to open prison cells, to free the innocent from their chains. Prayer cleanses from sin, drives away temptations, stamps out persecutions, comforts the faint-hearted, gives new strength to the courageous, brings travelers safely home, calms the waves, confounds robbers, feeds the poor, overrules the rich, lifts up the fallen, supports those who are falling, sustains those who stand firm. All the angels pray. Every creature prays. Cattle and wild beasts pray and bend the knee. As they come from their barns and caves, they look out to heaven and call out, lifting up their spirit in their own fashion. The birds, too, rise and lift themselves up to heaven. They open out their wings instead of hands, in the form of a cross, and give voice to what seems to be a prayer. What more need be said on the duty of prayer? Even the Lord himself prayed. To him be honor and power, forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. May God bless you. May God love you. May God's peace be with you. Please pray for me as I pray for you.